first to the second Saturday of every month, and at 11 a.m. rather than 1 p.m. So that will be our regular schedule from now on. And today, as always, we continue the series by reference to the last, not only the last lecture, but the last two lectures. So December and November. So in January, we're building on the last two lectures. And our topic today, as you might have seen advertised, and I'm using the Latin here, the Latin maxim, lex orandi, lex credendi, lex vivendi. Wow, that's a mouthful. So lex in Latin is the law or the rule. Orandi, orans, to pray. The rule of prayer is the rule of credendi, belief, and that is the rule of life. So as we worship, as we pray or worship, so we believe, and so we live. The intersection of liturgy and doctrine and life, real life. Because sometimes there's been a tendency, especially in the Latin West, the West in general, to disconnect these areas. And so what I'd like to do today, as we ponder, reflect upon this maxim, as we worship, so we believe, and so we live, is to reflect upon it from a perspective, a Byzantine perspective, Orthodox perspective, and apply that as well to universal Christianity, both East and West. And drawing, as I mentioned, upon the previous two lectures, we're going to see the Spirit as that which links all of it together. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, specifically in the life, in the ministry of the Lord himself. Because if we're not focused on the Lord in this, and this, and in this, then we're not Christian. So I'd like to reflect again upon the theological underpinnings of this, in reference to the Spirit, in reference to the Lord, both of whom are sent by the Father, and therefore made reference to the previous two lectures where we discussed that triune, one in three mystery. The mystery, as you recall, of the Trinity, as we focused the so-called immanent or transcendent Trinity, the Trinity ad intra, the Trinity within itself. The most important thing I said you can say about that is that we're in the realm of mystery that is inaccessible, ineffable, incomprehensible, invisible, all those things we mention in the Eucharistic prayer or anaphora of the divine liturgy. And that God is Father, Son, and Spirit. And it is a relationship of persons, capital P, the Son, eternally begotten by the Father, receiving everything from the Father and returning all received to the Father in an intimate relationship of love. That very love is the Spirit of God, breathed forth from the Father. And so there is an interrelationship where the Father is, the Son is, where the Son is, the Father is, and the Spirit is there in all of this mystery, as that which is the very glory of that divine love. And this Trinity, the immanent Trinity, the transcendent Trinity, the Trinity ad intra, is not a different Trinity, but the same Trinity that is what we call the economic Trinity. The Trinity, our God, ad extra, outside of himself. the act of creation and salvation and sanctification. Such that there is the same relationship of persons here as here. God, love, doing what love does, communicating, revealing, going outside oneself to create, to save that creation in its need, and to sanctify, which is the work of the Spirit, to bring creation back to God in a oneness that Byzantine theology focuses in on as theosis. That God creates in order to bring his creation to himself in a transformation from within. In terms of worship then, in terms of belief, in terms of life, we are caught up immediately then into this mystery of the Trinity. And the Spirit itself who gives us access to that mystery as the source for this unity. We worship in spirit and in truth. Which is to say, we worship this God, not as we make God up as we go along, but as God has been revealed and communicated to us in word and in deed. And that communication, that self-revelation, begins at the Annunciation. Where a young woman, Mary of Nazareth, has her descent of the Holy Spirit, has her Pentecost, if you will. The hypostasis, which is in Greek the person of the Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, the Comforter, the Paraclete, not just in gift, but in personhood, capital P, enters into the small p person of Mary and dwells in her, inhabits her, transforms her, such that she becomes in a unique way the Spirit bearer. And in a synergy of wills is able to say yes to this plan of God, the original creative plan, which is that God creates in order to again bring his creation to himself. The mystery of the Incarnation. That union without confusion or mixture, that union of the human and the divine, of the uncreated and the created, of spirit and matter. It is because of this first Pentecost, this first descent and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that this incarnation is possible. That this union of the human and the divine is made possible in Jesus the Lord. And that union of the divine and of the human, in the mystery of the Incarnation, the redemptive Incarnation, is made possible by the Holy Spirit. That union is the mystery of the Spirit, the very mystery of the Spirit. The Logos, the Word of God, the only begotten Son, the image of the Father, in humanity, because of his enfleshment, and humanity in the Son. Not the mixture, like we put fruit in a blender, becomes something else of the divine and the human. Each is distinct, retaining its unique characteristics, distinct properties, as human on the one hand, divine on the other, and yet inseparable. In this mystery of incarnation, of enfleshment of the Logos. The Spirit is itself that principle of unity of the divine and the human, by which our worship and belief and life in Christ can happen in the first place. And so Pentecost, the descent, the outpouring of the Spirit, becomes for us this point of reference. What does this mean and how do we do it? In truth, in spirit, and in truth. And we just celebrated the mystery of the Incarnation, the Nativity of the Lord. 13 days on the Julian calendar after the Gregorian, the Western Gregorian calendar. And we are about to celebrate what the West already celebrated, the baptism of the Lord. We celebrate the theophany of the Lord. This baptism is a theophany with the Spirit at its center. And of course, the voice of the Father descending upon the Son with the dove, which is the very love between the Father and the Son. That descent of the Holy Spirit under the form of a dove is the Pentecost of the Lord in his baptism. So the Pentecost of Mary is the Annunciation. The Pentecost of the Lord in his sacred humanity is his baptism. And what does the Spirit accomplish in the Lord at that baptism by that means? Which is that which is eternal in the Trinity ad infra, this relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, in distinction of persons, but where one is, the other are also. So too happens in the mystery of the Lord's humanity, that his human nature is baptized in the Spirit, anointed by the Holy Spirit, that he is Messiah, that he is Lord, that he is Christos, the anointed one, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that from this point on, his words and his deeds through that humanity will be the fulfillment of the Father's love, the Father's will, a synergy of wills made possible in the power of the Spirit, divine love itself. And so in the Theophany, we celebrate this mystery of the Spirit filling, dwelling, using as a means of divine self-communication the very humanity of the Lord. And this fulfills all of the ancient messianic hopes and promises going back to look at that passage just for a moment here. From Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because of which he anointed me. He sent me to proclaim good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to declare the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of recompense, and to comfort all who mourn, to give those who mourn in Zion glory instead of ashes, the oil of gladness to those who mourn, the garments of glory instead of a spirit of indifference. They shall be called generations of righteousness, the planting of the Lord for glory. In Luke 4:18, after his baptism, one of his first acts, the Lord in the synagogue takes the scroll and he reads this very passage. I'll be here for a second. Then he went down to Capernaum, the city of Galilee, and was So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as was his custom, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. When he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, all the eyes of those present in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." And so, this first fruit of the baptism of the Lord, this announcement, this proclamation that he is the fulfillment of these ancient messianic hopes and promises by this anointing of the Spirit, means that from that point on, all of his words and deeds are Spirit-filled, which is they're filled with divine love, communicated in a human way. And so everything about Jesus is then the fulfillment of God's creative, saving, and sanctifying plan. His ministry of word and deed. His passion. His glorification. This entire mystery, seen as it were as one, is the fruit of the work of the Holy Spirit through his humanity. In his ministry, he fulfills this passage from Isaiah. In his passion and death on the cross, he takes on the alienation, the isolation from God of a fallen humanity, and restores that broken relationship. Through a covenant renewed by his own blood, the shedding of his blood, by a sacrifice by which he becomes the Passover, the Paschal Lamb, and by the glorification that his death brings, trampling down death by death and upon those in the tombs, bestowing life in resurrection, and the glory of his return to the Father, by means of which his humanity and your humanity in him is brought home to the Father. And in that glorification, almost as a single event, again, we receive what Our Lady received at the Annunciation, her Pentecost. We receive what the Lord received at his baptism, his Pentecost. We receive the Spirit in our Pentecost, which is the descent and outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon the 12 and upon all of the church in the upper room in Jerusalem. And what that means is that this same Spirit present throughout all of these mysteries is now present to bring us into all of this event, which is to say the mystery of Christ himself. The power of the Spirit, the work of the Spirit, the mission of the Spirit is to bring all of this Trinitarian love in God's creative, saving, and sanctifying plan into your life and mine as one people, to save and to sanctify us. By bringing us into this ministry, this passion, this glorification as a here and now event, which only the Holy Spirit can accomplish. And so the power of the Spirit descends at Pentecost, not just upon the Virgin at the Annunciation or upon the Lord at his baptism, but these make possible, these saving events, this ultimate event, which is that the Spirit is now in all the world to Christify that world, the Christification of all creation, the Eucharistization, I made that word up, the Eucharistization of all of the cosmos, of all of creation. So that by the power of the Spirit, the work of the Spirit is to bring the Son's work into our lives. This gift as I said last month, must be received. I told the story about the person who had won a gift on a radio program, a free trip to Vegas. All expenses paid for 2 weeks. And when he got back, the radio announcer said to him on this program, they wanted to see how it went and everything, and the announcer said to him, the recipient, "That must have been wonderful to find out you won this free trip." And the man said, "It was wonderful, but there was something more wonderful than that." And the announcer said, "What could be more wonderful than finding out you won this free trip, this gift?" And the man said, "Getting there." Finding out you've won is one thing. Getting there and enjoying the trip is quite another. The Spirit gets us there. The Spirit allows us to receive this gift of all that the Spirit accomplishes in and through Jesus, in his historical ministry, in his passion, death on the cross, burial in the tomb, resurrection, return to the Father. It's all yours. It's all for you. It's all about you, so that you can be all about God. This marvelous exchange of wills, this synergy of wills, this transformation we call theosis. And so the work of the Spirit is a continual Pentecost. A continual Pentecost in our lives as we become formed by that power of the Spirit into the very body, the mystical body of Christ. No longer alone, but members by water and the Holy Spirit in our own baptism, which is incorporation into the body of Christ. And thus, temples of the Spirit, because it is by the power, the mission of the Holy Spirit, that that new life in Christ, that new clothing in Christ, is made possible for us. And what is the first gift of the Spirit for us? It is that all of this again be reactualized, renewed in our lives on a regular basis. How so? The Son's last gift, His farewell discourse in the Gospel of John, is the promise of the Spirit. And what will the Spirit accomplish? That what he does in that Last Supper is made accessible to us. What does he do? He anticipates his death, and he identifies himself with the substance that we ourselves make, but which are gifts to us: bread, the work of human hands; wine, grapes crushed. And we offer that to God in the blessing. And yet by the power of the Spirit, this gift of food, of bread and wine, is identified by the Lord with his own sacrificial death, his own holy oblation to the Father, his gift, his surrender of himself on behalf of us to the Father's love. It is a saving death. It is a death that conquers down death, that triumphs over death, and restores new life in the power of the resurrection. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, this Eucharist is made possible for us. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, the mystery of the incarnation, the mission, the death, the resurrection of the Lord, which is summed up, as it were, in this Eucharist. His presence means all of his life, death, and resurrection. The Paschal mystery, the Passover accomplished in him, fulfilling the Passover of ancient Israel. This is accessible to us as food and as drink. How so? By the power of the Holy Spirit. The same Spirit that transforms Our Lady at the Annunciation, that saturates and fills the sacred humanity of the Lord in his baptism by the Pentecostal grace of continued presence of that Spirit, makes possible for us the mission of Christ realized in each and every Eucharist. In time, but beyond time, including all time. So that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we receive, we don't make up as we go along, we receive a form of worship, a form of praise and thanksgiving to God that is the direct result of the work of the Holy Spirit to bring Christ to us in Eucharistic sacrifice, in Eucharistic meal, in Eucharistic communion with one another. And so, by that power of the Spirit, the first Christian community begins to do exactly this, to get together and to proclaim this death and resurrection, and to invoke the power of the Holy Spirit upon these gifts, because this is the action received, handed down, the traditio, the tradition that the 12 received at the Last Supper. And the promise that they could make this forever their own, the church's own, is the promise of the Spirit that the Lord announces in the farewell discourse in the Gospel of John. So that his injunction, do this in memory of me, might be able to be accomplished. And it is the gift of the Lord that we receive, coming home, as it were, by that power of divine love, the Holy Spirit. And so St. Paul then introduces us to this original reality that in the church, and here's where our Protestant brothers and sisters can seem to part with us in a different understanding. In Eastern and classical Western Christianity, tradition is not something opposed to or separate from Scripture, and certainly we don't believe in sola scriptura. Tradition makes of the church not a museum, but a flourishing garden. It is living tradition. How? By the power of the Spirit. And so St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 26, to the community to which he is writing, I received from the Lord what I handed down to you. That on the night before he suffered, before he was betrayed, the Lord took bread and wine and said over them, this is my body, this is my blood. The kernel of the Eucharist, this mystery, is handed down in oral tradition before, decades before, the New Testament was written. And so tradition is the life of the church. It is the Holy Spirit within the church continuing what has been transmitted, handed down by the Lord himself to the apostles and through them to the universal church. Not as a dead memory from the past, but as a living reality. And not as something conservative in the sense of a museum piece, but to conserve, to preserve a life. Not a corpse, but a life. And that is the very life of God accessible to us by the Holy Spirit. And so we live this first worship, as St. Paul testifies. We do what the Lord said, do this in memory of me. And so before the church is creedal, it is liturgical. And that liturgy is life for us. And so the life of the Spirit is this life, our lex orandi, our rule of worship. We do what was handed down. And the church does, by the power of the Spirit, what ancient Israel did. It receives that same form, the temple worship, which would be destroyed, of course, is nevertheless renewed in the new Israel by a new sacrifice, not of lambs, not of goats, but of the Lord himself. We say that in our prayer, the Eucharistic prayer, the anaphora. Do good to Zion in thy good pleasure. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then thou wilt be pleased with bright sacrifices, with burnt offerings, with whole burnt offerings and oblations. Then bulls will be offered unto thee. What are we talking about? What the high priest, the priest did, the sacrifice of animals in the temple. Who replaces that sacrifice? The Lord. his flesh and blood sacrificed in his crucifixion and his death on the cross for us. And so there is a sacrificial character to the liturgy that we don't make up, that we received from ancient Israel, and the Lord as the fulfillment of that, as he makes very clear in not only the Synoptic Gospels, but especially the Gospel of John and the farewell discourse. He is the lamb broken. He is the lamb whose blood is shed, the sheep led to the slaughter. In addition to the temple worship of sacrifice, the priesthood and sacrifice, there is the synagogue, or home worship of the people, that the Christians adopt as their own. Not in contrast to, but in full continuity with the Jewish community. It is the Jewish community, renewed by the power of the Spirit. And so, the reading of the scriptures, the recitation, the singing, the chanting of the psalms and hymns becomes part of Christian worship. And this develops organically. The whole liturgical calendar, Pascha, the fulfillment of Passover, Sunday, the Sabbath, the day of rest, the day of creation, the day of resurrection, the day of Pentecost, the creative, saving, and sanctifying plan of God, all renewed and celebrated on a single day of rest. The church's liturgical calendar of feasts that develops organically as its understanding of the mystery of the Lord gets celebrated, not all at once, what human can do that, but piece by piece by piece, as we do in our feasts, starting with Nativity and then moving to baptism and moving through the words and deeds of the Lord, his journey to Jerusalem, his passion, death, resurrection, Pentecost, step by step by step, renewed annually in the liturgical calendar. All of this was evolving, all of this was developing, all of this was simply being done before there was what we would call creeds or a Bible. Where did that Bible come from? Who developed the canon of sacred scripture? Who determined it? The church. And those creeds of the early councils of the church came from what? From this. And what is this? The work of the Spirit, who brings us to the work of Christ and makes that work, that life, that death, that resurrection our own. The mystery of Christ in us. We're already worshiping that before we're developing it and articulating it in more formal terms. This in synergy. But when the church looks to what it believes and wants to articulate that in clarification from those who are saying something different, what does it look to? The tradition. The tradition of what? Of worship, of liturgical worship. Lex orandi, lex credendi, lex vivendi. If this gets altered, this gets altered first, and this gets altered, then what gets altered as well? The very life that we have in Christ. The very life that we have in Christ. And so that life and the belief that forms that life depends upon the rule of worship. And that rule, again, is not something we make up as we go along, but what we receive, the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is the mystery of Christ, accessible to us in the Eucharist. And everything else that revolves around the Eucharist, the sacraments, the mysteries of Christ, the office of the church, which is all scripture, all Old Testament readings, prayers, psalms, canticles, fulfilled in the New Testament, and the mysteries celebrated in these great and glorious feasts throughout the year. The temptation in the West has been to alter the natural course of things, the natural organic evolutionary development of all of this. Because what is this opposed to? That which is outside of Christ, that which is opposed to this rule of worship, that which is antithetical to or resists the mystery of Christ and the power of his Spirit. St. Paul speaks of that opposition. You know, the law of the flesh, the law of our fallen human nature, opposed to the work, the law of the Spirit. And so if we say, well, we'll adapt all of this to that other law, the law of my fallen human nature, and we'll trim this and trim that, or maybe we'll throw it out altogether and put it into like a lab, petri dish in a laboratory, we'll reinvent it all, you know, in order to adapt to a secular, so-called modern mentality, then that alteration of worship, however well advertised, can be a different product in some respects, and can affect, as we've seen in the West, belief and life. A gradual, and now not so gradual, decline, some would say annihilation, of Christianity in entire nations. You know, the loss of faith. Byzantine Christianity does not have the hierarchical organism by which that could happen. And so no one group of people, no liturgical committee, if you will, could say, we're going to subject this to our will. Because liturgy is the work of the people. More precisely, it is the work of God. That's the whole point, the work of the Spirit done by the people. And that means that the liturgy doesn't belong to the Vatican, it doesn't belong to a patriarch, it doesn't belong to a priest, it belongs to the church, the whole church, which has received this tradition. And therefore, guided by the Spirit, it has to avoid two temptations. In Russian Christianity, I'll focus just on Russian history for a moment, these two opposite traditions one was found in the schism of the old believers. You guys that are familiar with Russian Christianity know what that is. That I mistake the tradition, which is something living, with something dead, a corpse. Something dead that I'm just remembering, a museum. Tradition is always organic, it's living, and its essence is the Eucharist, by the power of the Spirit. If I inflate an accident of history, a particular ritual that is second or third on the tier of importance for the essence itself, then I make a theological error and I turn the liturgy into a museum piece. The liturgy has always been open to organic development, but that is organic development, evolutionary development, built upon and not in any way taking away from what went before. Okay, so the old believers were ready to sacrifice their lives for certain rituals, which were secondary in importance or even third on the rung of the ladder of importance. They're very, very courageous and but one could say fanatical, in a traditionalist approach to this that did not admit of organic development, frozen in a particular moment in time, refusing to grow beyond that moment. On the other hand, in the beginning of the Bolshevik Revolution, you had the Bolsheviks use and infiltrate the church and use particular individuals for what they wanted to establish, a so-called living church. Which would basically be what some have felt were the results of the early years of the Novus Ordo Roman Mass, which was anything goes, a circus. But at least you're chic, you're adapted to modern culture, you're up to date, and you're entertaining the masses, basically. But are you worshiping God, or Spirit, you know, clown masses and all of that sort of stuff that we saw in the 70s. When I was in the seminary, the liturgy, based upon this, became an endless hectic enterprise, an endless task. We had liturgy committees. We would make all this up as we went along week by week. And the liturgy committee that invented the Mass for the community for that last week, if they had done a skit or a drama, you know, then the pressure was on you to do something better, Cecil B. DeMille production even better than last week's liturgy committee. It was an exhausting enterprise. You couldn't just go to Mass and pray the prayers of the Mass. It all had to be reinvented because it was, we had to be living, the living, up-to-date, current, novel church, you know, out of the lab experiment or out of the theatrical rehearsal group or something like that. And so both of these extremes affect then belief. In one way or another, they give us a diminished or distorted version of the mystery of Christ because they are no longer spirit-led, but man-centered. We replace God with ourselves and call it worship. And then everything begins to fall apart with regard to the distinctiveness of Christian discipleship, faith and discipleship. Because we're no longer interested in that distinctiveness. We want to blend in and amalgamate and be part of everybody. Here comes everybody. But everybody doesn't believe in anything. So you've lost the faith. You've lost the faith. And you've lost the spirit of the liturgy itself. And so Byzantine Christianity avoids these two extremes by focusing on the heart of the matter, which is what St. Paul said. I handed on to you what I received from the Lord. How did he receive it from the Lord? The Lord was, his historical ministry has already been accomplished by the time of Paul's conversion. How did Paul receive anything from the Lord? By the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. The church was already Christ, post-Pentecost, and therefore able to live what the Lord had handed on to the apostles in divine worship and hand on in the living tradition. And so Byzantine Christianity conserves in its liturgy by its very nature, doesn't make it up through liturgy committees week by week. What should we do this week? Carol, what should we do this Sunday? What do you think we should do for the divine liturgy this Sunday? You know? Anybody have any ideas? Could you do a skit? Could you put on a drama for us? Could you do a theatrical production? Could you, you know, we'll make it up as we go along, week by week, and it'll be a smash hit. The only problem is next week you have to be even better. And the week after that you have to outdo them. You know, it's like, oh my goodness, you know, can't we just celebrate the divine liturgy? We were exhausted as seminarians with that mentality. You know, it always had to be more entertaining. Because the mentality was they were all there to be entertained and not to worship. And so the Spirit moves us out of that self-absorbed context, because when we're living in that self-absorption, we're already out of the mystery of redemption. We need to be redeemed from that self-absorption and focused instead on God. So a God-centered liturgy rather than a man-centered liturgy is what Byzantine Christian worship has always tried to maintain and preserve, without becoming a museum piece, and that's the challenge. At the other hand, without being a free-for-all, the chaos of self-absorbed work of human hands, we create this, we make it up as we go along week by week. So let's arondi, the rule of worship is not just following rubrics, it is following and forming what we believe and how we live. And it maintains orthodoxy. Orthodoxy, orthopraxis, correct belief and correct way of life, is founded on correct worship. Orthodoxy is really first and foremost correct worship. And it is rooted in Christ, accessible to us by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not rules and regulations that we hand on as man-made traditions. It is something authentic, but accessible to us, unchanging, but ever new and present to us, and only the Holy Spirit can accomplish that feat. Ever ancient, ever new. And it therefore maintains that this worship and this belief and this life are not divided up, but are one. If we say, for example, oh, I believe in certain things, but in the concrete circumstances of my life, not so much, you know. Or we worship in a certain way, but we really don't believe that anymore. Then we divide Christ himself. But if we have access to the real Christ, which is by the power of his Spirit, because the work of the Spirit is to bring us Christ, not to bring us the Spirit for the sake of the Spirit, but to make Christ alive in us and in the world until the final parousia. The work of the Spirit is eschatological and Christological for that reason. But that Christ is the one who said of himself, I am the truth. Truth is not, in classical Christianity, a set of abstract concepts or propositions to be believed. Memorize the DMV manual, thank you very much, and then you can be baptized and chrismated. Truth is a person, capital P, the incarnate Word of God, Christ in our midst, God in our midst, in Jesus Christ. The truth is living. It's a person. It's a personal encounter. It's a personal relationship that changes you from within by the power of the Holy Spirit in a way the DMV manual could never do, or even a catechism, however true. It's outlined. Christ is the truth. And he makes possible that truth is life, able to be lived. To separate truth from life is a schizophrenic enterprise where it's a subtle Christological heresy. Because doctrine and praxis have to be the same thing. How so? How can I bridge this gap that I myself might tend to create between these two? In Christ, by the power of his Spirit. Which Christ? The Christ who also said of himself, I am the way. The way to unite this and this in one. Not a formula, but a person, capital P, accessible again by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so it is Christ in the Spirit, who makes possible lex orandi, lex credendi, lex vivendi, truth, life, and way of life in one unified whole that changes me from within and that keeps me orthodox in worship, in belief, and in life. Not a museum, something conserved, preserved, protected, but not a museum, but a flourishing garden of life. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to live this mystery of Christ. As we worship, so we believe, and so we live. Does that make sense?
Yes. If I remember my Catholic catechism, that the Catholic Church is like a three-legged stool and it's built on three things, and I noticed two of them that you have. It's sacred scripture, sacred tradition, but the third leg is the magisterium. In the Eastern churches, apparently the magisterium is not part of the...
Oh no, the bishops would constitute the hierarchical magisterium and teaching authority, especially when they, each bishop in his own diocese,
right,
and in councils and synods where they articulate the faith of the church, again, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So those three. Scripture is the written manifestation of the Word of God. Tradition would be the context within which that written manifestation is possible, the oral transmission. And that whole life is guarded by the teaching authority, the shepherds of the church, who are meant not to make it up as they go along, but to guard this original tradition. As St. Paul said, I hand on to you what I myself received from the Lord, which is to say the power of the Holy Spirit. So those three things are there in organic unity. But the Orthodox Church especially would see liturgy as the primal way in which all of this is brought together and celebrated. So that even if everything else seems to be smashed or taken away, the church would still continue to exist. When the Soviet Union fell, they asked the Patriarch of Moscow, what were you doing when you were all unable to do anything? You know, when everything was illegal and you couldn't have catechism classes and run schools and that sort of thing, meet together in councils, you know, local synods as bishops because it was illegal to do so. What were you doing? And he said, we were celebrating the divine liturgy. The divine liturgy itself kept everything else alive, you know, so that when the Soviet Union fell, because the liturgy, in however clandestine a manner, was able to be celebrated, this worship had preserved this and this, at least potentially, so that it could be reactivated by God's grace after even a terrible persecution such as they had endured. So this tradition keeps alive the incarnation, it keeps alive the written word of God. As I said before, we inherit that whole of sacred scripture from ancient Israel. That is our liturgy, our readings, our texts, our hymns, the Psalms, and the Divine Office, and the great Vesper services, the great feast of the liturgical year. We also transmit, however, by the power of the Spirit, a focus on what the incarnation means. So that for the East in particular, because this mystery was challenged in a heresy called iconoclasm, we have a focus, the opposite focus, which is on the not only is there a written word, but the word of God through the eyes, through the visual word, if you will, through icons. And so iconographers, this is part of the tradition, part of the liturgy of the church, are able to manifest the reality of the incarnation by writing, quote-unquote, an icon, which is sacred scripture visual. The gospel's not written, not heard, proclaimed, but seen through the mystery of the icons, the mystery of Christ, who, if he is not God in our midst, is not able to be manifested. But if he is God and flesh, then he is able to be seen and portrayed in imagery and the Mother of God and the saints. So the icons become part of this living tradition of liturgical worship in Byzantine Christianity that preserves the work of the Spirit, which is the incarnation itself. When the power of the Holy Spirit descends upon the gifts of bread and wine to fulfill the mandate, the mission of the Lord, that his mystery is reactualized. The mystery of his passion, his death, death on the cross, burial in the tomb, his resurrection, that is accomplished by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we invoke the Holy Spirit in the epiclesis of the liturgy. And then we remember. What's the opposite of amnesia? To forget. And amnesis, to remember. What do we remember? In the Byzantine liturgy, we focus on what the Lord has accomplished, and even in our remembrance on what is yet to happen. It's eschatological. We celebrate the ascension, the return of the Lord, the sitting at his right hand in glory by the side of the Father, and his second and glorious coming. When did that happen? I think I missed it. It hasn't happened yet. And yet we're already remembering it, a saving event. We're in time, but beyond time. How can that happen? Because we're in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we begin our liturgy in that way. Blessed is the kingdom. What is the kingdom? The Spirit. Making accessible to us that triune mystery that I was talking about at the beginning. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The entire mystery of God's creative, saving, and sanctifying love is there in the universe. Absolute transcendent. And we become he whom we receive. So the invocation of the Holy Spirit isn't just upon the gifts, the bread and the wine, but ourselves. May we receive the communion of the Holy Spirit. And therefore, the fulfillment of the kingdom of heaven, which is that by receiving the Holy Spirit, you are in that kingdom, thus fulfilling God's plan for you and all of us as church, and indeed the whole world. So all of these prayers that we... What if a liturgy committee came and said, you know, I don't like that. I don't think people are good. I don't think young people are going to understand that. So we'll get a red felt pen and we'll go, and they'll never hear it. Generations later, you wonder why they're not in church and why they don't believe anything anymore. Who could have done that? I don't know, sister, who could have? Look in the mirror, you know? And so we what this does, what the power of the Spirit does, is not sell kids short. It says, yeah, children have an instinct just like adults for God, and we're not going to deprive them of the rich banquet God himself has prepared for them. It doesn't mean that we don't adapt, you know, for the mentality of a child. Of course you do that. Anyone knows to do that. But you're not eliminating things that you've decided aren't right for them. Maybe God's decided something else. And so tradition is living tradition, but it's trusting in the power of the Spirit to move the hearts of the young and the old into the mystery of Christ, and according to what they're able to digest of that at different times, different portions of their life, and times of their life, circumstances of their life.
Ask one more question. When you were talking about, say, the Protestantism, and the idea that, you know, you needed to change your liturgy every week, my understanding of Protestantism has an emphasis on the horizontal and not as much on the vertical, and traditional churches like the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern churches emphasize the vertical and not as much the horizontal.
The Novus Ordo was a decided re-emphasis on the horizontal. And so for many people, they had a different experience of liturgy after that than what they had had before. And now we have two rites within the Roman tradition, which are, you know, so that's an issue that will have to be addressed, and hopefully unity comes somehow. But in the Byzantine tradition, you wouldn't have had a liturgical commission for all of Byzantine Christianity tell the Orthodox Church from one weekend to the next that their entire service had been changed. That could never happen in the Orthodox or Byzantine Christian, Byzantine Catholic tradition, because the understanding of tradition and liturgy is everything I've just described as different than in the West. Yes?
So it's interesting you bring up the significance of this for children.
I think we're just about to end now.